The last talk of today will be given by Professor Giulio Cerullo from Mali University, Politecnico di Milano. I think it's a really a great opportunity to have here Giulio, because I have to say that, okay, we collaborate a lot, but for sure when I think about a very talented researcher, I think about Giulio Cerullo. So he was graduating in Politecnico di Milano, then he was traveling a lot in Germany and in Berkeley University, and now he's full professor at Politecnico di Milano, and he's teaching also a course that he's talking about this, so he's also delivering some knowledge that is usually given to the master students of physics engineering. So please do.
Okay, so thank you, Francesco, for this kind introduction. Yes, this lecture is going to be probably on a much lower level with respect to the ones that I heard before. So it's going to be really like a classroom style lecture on OPOs and OPAs. So I'm going to introduce you to the very basic concept of these optical devices that serve basically to change, that exploit nonlinear optics to change the color of light, to turn a coherent light source, which is a laser, which typically works at a specific frequency, into a tunable light source. So that's why these sources now have become really ubiquitous in many laboratories. Now, since this is a really basic introduction, so I'm going to say a few things that might sound trivial to most of you. So I'm going to give you a really basic introduction to nonlinear optics. So when do we? So nonlinear optics is happens when you have a high intensity electromagnetic waves that traverses a material. So if you stay in the linear regime, what happens when an electromagnetic wave crosses a material? You are inducing in the atoms or the molecules a time-varying polarization by deformation or orientation of the atoms and molecules, and this polarization drives light emission. And when you are at low intensities, when you have weak electric fields of light, the polarization is a linear function of the field. But now, as you start to crank up the electric field, you start to crank up the intensity of light, then you start to see any oscillator, when it's driven with very large amplitude, it becomes anharmonic. So you start to see, in a way, distortions, and you start to get nonlinear terms that are proportional, not anymore to the first power of the electric field, but to the square, to the third power. And so the birth of nonlinear optics is almost simultaneous with the birth of the laser, because without a laser, you cannot have enough intensity to have a nonlinear optical effect. In fact, if you consider that the laser was born in 1960, the first paper on second harmonic generation is dated from 61 or 62. And this paper was essentially just shining a laser on a nonlinear optical material. You see immediately these new terms coming up that give rise to the nonlinear response. Now, if you take the term which is proportional to the square of the electric field, this is the second order nonlinear polarization, and this is responsible, for example, for the phenomenon of second harmonic generation. So you generate light that has double frequency with respect to the incoming light, or optical parametric generation. This is going to be the focus of today's talk. Now, if you go to even higher fields, then the third order term starts to become important. And then you have a lot of effects. The most important effects are the so-called self-effects of light, self-focusing and self-phase modulation. So essentially, light modifies the refractive index of the medium in which it propagates in a way proportional to its intensity. So it modifies itself, its propagation properties. And now, if we go to the second order nonlinear optics, we can easily understand what happens if we take a crystal with a second order nonlinear susceptibility and we enter with two monochromatic fields at frequencies omega 1 and omega 2. We write the electric field of these two monochromatic waves in this way, where you have here the complex conjugate, because the electric field is a real quantity, so you write it in this way. Now you write very simply a polarization, a second order polarization, which is just the square of this electric field. So you simply square this expression, and if you do the mathematics, you see a very rich physics is coming out. You see a lot of terms. And now each of these terms corresponds to a different second order nonlinear effect. For example, if you take the first term, this one, you see this is a field that is a constant, because now you have multiplied this by the complex conjugate, so you get essentially a constant field. So this is the phenomenon known as optical rectification. So if you do this with a short light pulse, you don't really get a constant frequency, but you go to very low frequencies. You go to the so-called terahertz domain. And this optical rectification, these terahertz frequencies are very important for many applications. This is a manifestation of second order nonlinear response. Then you take the squares, so you take 2 omega 1 and 2 omega 2. This is the second harmonic generation. Okay? So you get electric field oscillating at twice the frequency. Then you get the double product. Okay? So you get omega 1 plus omega 2. This is the sum frequency generation. So you generate an electromagnetic wave at a frequency that is the sum of the frequencies of the two interacting waves. And then you get the difference, omega 1 minus omega 2, because you multiply this by the complex conjugate. Okay? And this is called the difference frequency generation. So you see, by doing this very simple maths, you get a lot of different frequencies, and you get a lot of different physical phenomena. Now, let's look at this phenomena a bit. So far, we are treating light like an electromagnetic wave. So we're simply taking the square of the electric field. Now, let's consider the corpuscular nature of light. Let's consider light as a flow of photons. How do we interpret this phenomena? Let's start with second harmonic generation. So second harmonic generation, very simply, you can interpret it as the absorption of two photons at frequency omega to virtual levels. So you are essentially annihilating two photons at frequency omega, and you generate one photon at the double frequency. Since the energy of a photon is h bar omega, of course, you are conserving energy. You annihilate two photons at omega, you generate one photon at 2 omega. Now, the sum frequency generation is pretty much the same. You annihilate one photon at omega 1, you annihilate one photon at omega 2, you emit one photon at the sum frequency. Again, of course, you must conserve energy. Now, let's look at the difference frequency generation, because this is different, and it's also very interesting. If you look at the difference frequency generation, you still come in with two photons. Here I'm writing, for example, I'm calling this frequency omega 3 and this frequency omega 1. I want to do the difference between omega 3 and omega 1. So in terms of energy conservation, what am I doing? I am annihilating one photon at omega 3, at the higher energy. I come in with one photon at omega 2, and now I emit a second photon. So I come with one, and I enter with one and exit with two. So I'm really amplifying now my field at omega 1. So I am annihilating one photon at the higher frequency, and I am emitting a photon at the lower frequency, omega 1. Now, of course, this doesn't satisfy the conservation of energy, so you need also to emit another photon, a third photon, at omega 2, which is exactly the difference. And now you are satisfying energy conservation. So you see now what you are doing, you are annihilating one photon at a higher frequency, and you are generating two photons input photon omega 1 is you're generating a second photon, so you are amplifying this field, and you also generate the difference frequency. Okay? Now, what is the difference? What is really an optical parametric amplifier? It is exactly the same process. Optical parametric amplifier is the same process as difference frequency generation, but it differs in the initial condition. In difference frequency generation, you assume that the two fields at omega 3 and omega 1 have comparable intensities. You have the comparable number of photons in omega 3 and omega 1. And then in this way, you generate essentially the difference frequency. On the other hand, in an optical parametric amplifier, you are now assuming that the omega 3 beam is much more intense. There are a lot of photons at omega 3 and only a very few number of photons at omega 1. So omega 1 is called the signal and omega 2 is called, omega 3 is called the pump. So in the, now you are coming in with a few with very few photons at omega 1 and with a very strong beam at omega 3, which is the pump. Now you are amplifying, so the main effect is that now you are increasing a lot the intensity of the signal. So you're really having an optical amplifier. And of course, in order to satisfy energy, you also generate this omega 2, which is the difference, omega 3. And this is called, for historical reasons, the idler. So this is, we call omega 3 the pump, omega 1 the signal, and omega 2 the idler. So you really have an optical amplifier, exactly like a laser. Now, what is the difference between an optical parametric amplifier and a laser? A laser, as you have probably heard a lot during this course, works through population inversion. So you have some real states which you populate and which live for some time. It can be nanoseconds, can be microseconds. And so you essentially, you are storing energy in a material, and then if you come with a photon of the right frequency, you stimulate the emission. This is the principle of the way. Here you have the same thing, but now you don't have real electronic states or vibrational states in which you accumulate the energy. Here you have only virtual states. So you can still get an optical amplifier, pretty much like a laser, but now only when the you have to have simultaneously the pump and the signal. So there is no energy storage. It only works instantaneously when the pump and the signal are simultaneously present. In a laser, you can pump, and then you can wait nanoseconds or even more, and then you can laser. Here, you can only amplify when the pump is present. Now, this has advantages and disadvantages. But now, there is another very big difference between an OPA and a laser. We know that a laser works between discrete electronic levels. So if you take a neodymium laser, it will work at 1 micron. If you take an erbium laser, it will laser 1.5, ytterbium. So you can have some tunability, but you have some specific transitions. Now, in this case, you are basically, you have much more freedom to amplify. And in a way, I like to call, I have heard it once, and this struck my mind, and I never forgot it. You can call the OPA a photon cutter. So how does it work? You take one photon of high energy. Imagine this long arrow, the pump. Now I want to cut it into the sum of two photons which have lower energy. And that's what I do. I come with my signal. I amplify my signal. So I'm generating one photon with lower energy. And then I generate my idler. So essentially now I take this arrow, the pump, and I cut it into the sum of two shorter arrows, which are the signal and the idler. Okay, now the beautiful thing about this is that basically now you are free. In how many ways can you cut these arrows into smaller arrows? Into infinite ways. So you can now tune over a very broad range your signal. So you can come with different signals and you can, in principle, amplify them, still satisfying the energy conservation principle. So you have immediately a tunable amplifier, which is very rare to obtain or almost, there are some tunable lasers. For example, titanium sapphire can be tuned, but only over a limited range. Other lasers can be tuned in other, but this concept in principle allows you to generate really a rainbow of colors because you start with a high energy photon, the pump, and you cut it into the sum of these two photons that you want to amplify. Now, what is the difference? In my talk, I had the title OPOs and OPAs. So what is the difference between an optical parametric oscillator and an optical parametric amplifier? It's basically the same difference between a laser and an optical amplifier. Now, what does the acronym LASER stand for? everybody knows, I guess, in this audience. Light amplification, but stimulated emission of radiation. But a laser, is it an amplifier or not? Is a laser an amplifier? It's not an amplifier. A laser is an oscillator. Okay, but a laser is an optical amplifier enclosed between two reflecting mirrors. Okay, so you get an optical gain medium, some medium that can amplify the light, but then you have to have a feedback, you have to have a positive feedback, like in electronics. If you take an electronic amplifier and you put it a positive feedback, what does this amplifier become? It becomes an oscillator, which is typically bad for electronics. But for a laser, that's what you want. You want to have a positive feedback and turn the amplifier into an oscillator. So the same thing is true here. If you take this optical amplifier and you enclose it between mirrors, you get an oscillator. But now this is not bad, it's exactly like a laser, but now the gain medium is not a real gain medium with population inversion, it's just a nonlinear crystal, a Ki2 crystal. So on the other end, you can say, okay, I don't want to have an oscillator. I do what is called a traveling wave optical parametric amplifier. Now nobody uses this word anymore. It was at the beginning, people call it like this, but now everybody calls it just an OPA. Here you have such a strong gain, such a high gain, that you don't need to go back and forth. You just go once or twice through one or several crystals, and you just get your amplifier at the end. So it's just an oscillator without feedback. It's just the naked crystal that gives you the OPA. Now, what are advantages and disadvantages of OPO and OPA? So, of course, a femtosecond OPO requires much lower gain. What is the condition for a laser to lase? You have a cavity, you have some optical gain, and then you have some losses. When does a laser lase? When the gain exceeds the losses. So if you have a gain of 10%, if you have losses of 10%, you need a gain of at least 10% to go above threshold. So if you have a parametric gain of maybe 10, 15, 20%, you can easily make a cavity oscillate, so you get an OPO. So they can work at very high repetition rate, maybe 100 megahertz. So if you want to do experiments with high repetition rate, you get good signal to noise. On the other hand, they have low output energies. They are in the order of a nanojoule. And then there are some very nasty things about OPOs. I don't know if anybody of you has ever aligned an OPO. It's one of the most difficult things. So yeah, you have done your PhD, so you know. Why? Because in a laser, what do you need to do? You have an optical gain medium. Has anybody of you ever aligned a laser from scratch? So what do you need to do? You need to align the mirrors in such a way that they are parallel, and essentially that the light goes through a feedback. But now, and this can be difficult, but okay. On the other end, in an OPO, it's not enough to have the cavity aligned. Since you are pumping it synchronously, the pump laser comes periodically with some period, you need also to make sure that the cavity is exactly of the right length. So if the cavity has the wrong length, the OPO will not work. So you have an additional degree of freedom. And then you have even another degree of freedom, which is phase matching, as I will explain you later. So it can be very difficult to operate an OPO. And then also, they have a limited tuning range, because typically they employ mirrors, and these mirrors work only over a limited bandwidth. On the other hand, the OPA, they require pumping by amplified lasers. So in principle, you need a more expensive laser. You don't need simply an oscillator. You need an amplified laser. They provide typically lower repetition rate on the order of kilohertz. On the other hand, you can get very high output energy in an OPA, even well above a millijoule. They are easier to operate, much easier to align than an OPO, and you can tune them over a very broad range. So, of course, there are applications that require OPO and OPAs, but the core is the same. You still have this Ki2 crystal, but then each of them has some advantages, disadvantages. Now, in this talk, since I have very limited time, I'm going to focus essentially on OPAs. And now I'm going to do a little bit of theory of OPA. And to do this, we start by describing what happens if a light pulse propagates in a nonlinear medium. So we have to write a wave equation, and essentially we have to start from Maxwell's equation. So this is a Maxwell equation for an electromagnetic wave. You recognize Maxwell's equation. And you have on the right-hand side the second derivative of the polarization. So this is, if you take out this, you are propagating in vacuum. If you propagate in a material, you get this right-hand side. And this is very important because it tells us that the polarization is a source of electric field that modifies your pulse. So a pulse, when it propagates in a medium, it drives a polarization, which emits light, which modifies the field. Now, the polarization is made up of a linear and a nonlinear term. Now, the linear polarization, okay, is proportional to the dielectric constant, to the relative dielectric constant, while nonlinear polarization depends on the type of response. Now, here we can write this equation. Now, instead of going to C0, which is the speed of light in vacuum, we go to C, which is the speed of light in a medium. So here I am now considering the propagation in a medium. And I get this equation, where now I get this nonlinear polarization, which is my driving term. Now, I do another approximation, which is called the slowly varying envelope approximation. So I write my electric field of light in this way, where you have a carrier wave and you have an envelope. Here I am considering a monochromatic wave for the moment. And I write my nonlinear polarization. And now note that, you know, in an electromagnetic wave, you have the frequency omega and you have the wave vector k. Now, in a nonlinear polarization, you have a wave vector kp, which in general is not equal to the wave vector of light. And this is very important, as we will see in a moment. Now, we do a little bit of mathematics. Okay, maybe I think you should have these slides, so I can skip a bit. You do this so-called slowly varying envelope approximation. And in the end, you get this very simple equation that tells you how the amplitude of the electric field changes with propagation distance. I'm propagating now a plane wave along a distance z. Okay? And you have this polarization as a driving term. But you see that you have this term, which is the difference between the wave vector of the polarization and of the electric field of light. Now, we want to consider a second order interaction. So we consider now the superposition of three waves at frequencies omega 1, omega 2, and omega 3 with this condition, omega 1 plus omega 2 equal to omega 3. So we take this electric field, which is the sum of these three frequencies. And now we want to see how can we get a polarization, for example, at omega 3, which is omega 1 plus omega 2. Then it's easy. I have to multiply this by this. So I will get omega 3 will be the A1 multiplied by A2 multiplied by e to the I K1 plus K2z minus omega 1 plus omega 2, which is omega 3z. Now, if I want to get omega 1, omega 1 is omega 3 minus omega 2. So how do I get here omega minus omega 2? I have to take the complex conjugate. In fact, here you see that you get the complex conjugate. Then you get K3 minus K2, and then you get omega 1. And so you get the polarization at omega 2. Now, you have this three polarization, nonlinear polarization. Now, you essentially take this equation that I wrote before, and you put here for each of these three fields, you put the nonlinear polarization. And then you get the famous three coupled equations of second order nonlinear optics. So these are three equations that are very simple and that they can describe all second order nonlinear processes. So they are very powerful equations. You see that they are coupled, they are nonlinear equations, because here you have the product of the fields, and they are coupled. So A1 depends on A2 and A3 and so on. Now they are coupled through this coefficient, which is called the nonlinear optical coefficient, which is, somehow I think it is a function of the second order nonlinearity chi2. So this coefficient describes typically the second order nonlinearity. It's a number that for any material you can find tabulated. Of course, if you don't have any nonlinear response, second order nonlinear response, this coefficient goes to zero, and then all these equations become independent. So that the three waves, the three colors, they propagate without talking to each other. Each one goes in the medium independently. As soon as you switch on the nonlinearity, as soon as you switch on this coefficient, then you start getting coupling, meaning that each color talks to the other colors. Each color interacts with the other and exchanges energy. Now, note that here there is this term, which is K3, the wave vector K of the omega 3 minus K2 minus K1. This is very important because this is called the wave vector mismatch. Now, if we have these equations, what we can do is we can solve them within some approximations. So first approximation is we can assume that this delta K is equal to zero. This is called phase matching. Now, this is how to do it, I will explain later on. It is not easy, but it can be done. And normally when you do second order nonlinear optics, you need to achieve this. So you need to be in phase matching. Assuming that we can do it, then the other hypothesis that I can do is that I'm coming with a pump that is a very strong field. And so my signal and my idler are very weak. So I can assume that my pump is essentially almost unperturbed. It has so much energy that even if I amplify my signal, the loss of the pump is negligible. So this is the approximation, is the so-called no pump depletion approximation. So then this A3 becomes a constant. So the field of the pump, I can assume that it remains constant. And then I do a perfect phase matching, and I get this very simple equation. This is an equation for the field of the signal. So this is a second order linear equation with this parameter gamma, which depends, this parameter depends on the nonlinearity, and it depends on the intensity of the pump. So this is a nonlinear process, so of course it will be dependent on the intensity of the pump. Now, this equation can be solved mathematically, very simply. You get a hyperbolic cosine of gamma, where the gamma is this constant, multiplied by z, where z is the propagation. Now, hyperbolic cosine, and then you, this is for the signal, and then you get something similar for the idler. Now, what you can do is you can, hyperbolic cosine is e to the gamma z plus e to the minus gamma z. So if you neglect the e to the minus gamma z, because as you increase z, it will rapidly go to zero, you get some exponential growth. So in the end, you can write that the intensity of the pump is equal to the initial intensity multiplied by e to the 2 gamma l, where l is the length of the nonlinear crystal, is the propagation. So you get really an exponential growth of your signal. And so you get a real optical amplifier, exactly like in a laser. Also in a laser, you have an exponential growth. And this, of course, will depend on this parametric gain. And the parametric gain is a function of the intensity and of the nonlinear coefficient. So that's why you like to use a laser, an ultra-short pulse laser in particular, because with an ultra-short pulse laser, with a femtosecond laser, you concentrate all the energy in a short pulse, so you have a very high intensity. So you can get a really high parametric gain. So you really get an exponential growth of the signal with propagation length. Now, when you have an exponential growth, you typically have a positive feedback. So how can you understand this? You can make this very simple drawing. So you are having your pump, and you are coming with a weak signal. So what are you doing? First, you amplify, you transfer energy from the pump to the signal. So you amplify the signal, okay? Now, but in order to satisfy energy, you don't generate only the signal. You also generate the idler, okay? So you are essentially cutting the pump, the energy of the pump, you give part of the signal and part of the idler. So you are amplifying also the idler. But now, if you look back at these equations, you will see that they are perfectly symmetric. They are perfectly symmetric between A1 and A2. So now you can essentially exchange signal and idler, and you can say, okay, if I now go to this, now I can amplify the idler, so I get higher idler, but at the same time, if I amplify the idler, what do I need to generate? Also some signal. So now I feed back from the idler to the signal. So I get a real positive feedback, and this positive feedback gives rise to an exponential growth. So you can really have that within a short distance, you can amplify your signal by 3, 4, 5, 10 orders of magnitude, because you get this exponential growth. Okay? It's a real optical amplifier. Now, these are just some calculations taken for some realistic parameters for a crystal which is called BBO, beta barium borate, which is the most popular crystal in nonlinear optics because it has very good properties of also resistance to high intensities. So these are intensities that you can easily achieve with a femtosecond laser on the orders of 10, 50 to 100 gigawatt per square centimeter. If you take a length on the order of a few millimeter, you see you get easily gain of 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6. So you can amplify your signal in a single pass through a few millimeter long crystal, you can amplify your signal by a million times. So you can really make this traveling wave. So you enter with a very weak field, you first amplify it, and then if you want, you put another stage, you amplify it again, and in 2-3 stages, you can increase the energy by really many orders of magnitude, okay? Now, this is another example for if you pump the OPA in the blue at 400 nanometer, you see that the gain becomes even higher. You can even get 10 to the 7, 10 to the 8. So you can really get, with realistic intensities, extremely high parametric values of this parametric gain. So you have an optical amplifier which really can transfer the energy from the pump to the signal. Of course, when you start to amplify very much the signal, then some of the approximations that I have done break down because, of course, I cannot neglect anymore the pump depletion. If I start to get a very high efficiency, then the pump goes down, and then my equations become more complicated. But when you reach that limit, you're already working very well. So that's, I think these equations can serve as a guide. And then if you're really entering into this depletion regime, then you can do a more complex and accurate simulation. Okay, but now one trivial point. Of course, in nature, energy is always conserved. So also in a parametric interaction, you can manipulate these equations, and you can get this equation. So this equation is telling you that the sum of the derivatives with respect to Z of the three intensities is zero. So what does it mean? If I'm assuming a lossless medium, if I am neglecting losses, that there will be some losses for sure, but now I am neglecting them. So basically this tells me that overall I'm transferring energy from the pump to the signal and the idler. And the sum of the energies, of course, must remain constant. But there is another relationship, which is called the Manley-Rowe relationship, which now reads like this. 1 over omega 1 divide di 1 over z, 1 is equal to 1 over omega 2 di 2 over z is minus 1 over omega 3 di i3 over z. So this is very simple to understand if you consider that the intensity divided by the frequency gives the number of photons. So this is simply stating a photon conservation. So if I lose one photon at omega 3, because I am annihilating it, I am generating one photon at omega 1, but I must also generate simultaneously one photon at omega 2. So you see again the famous photon cutter. I am cutting one photon at omega 3, I get one photon omega 1, one photon at omega 2. Okay? Now comes the very important problem of phase matching. So far I said, okay, let's assume phase matching, but how do we do phase matching? Now, phase matching requires that the wave vector of the signal plus the wave vector of the idler is equal to the wave vector of the pump. Now, if you recall electromagnetism, the wave vector of an electromagnetic wave is omega multiplied by the refractive index n divided by the speed of light, c. So I can rewrite this equation in this way. Okay? Now, of course, the refractive index, everybody knows, depends on frequency. How is this not? How do you call this dependence of refractive index on frequency of any material? It's dispersion. Any material is dispersive, more or less. Only vacuum is non-dispersive. Even air is dispersive to some degree. So if you take what is called the normal dispersion, where the refractive index increases with frequency, which is the case in most in the visible and near infrared range, then you will get that n of omega 1, assuming this order of frequencies, n of omega 1 smaller than omega 2, smaller than n of omega 3. And now you can rewrite this condition in this way. And now if you consider the energy conservation, you can rearrange it like this. Now this is n omega 3 minus n of omega 2, which is positive, equal to n of omega 1 minus n of omega 2, which is negative, multiplied by omega 1 divided omega 3. So this is impossible. You cannot achieve phase matching in a medium with normal dispersion. You will always get a difference. So in an isotropic bulk material, there is no way to get phase matching. If you consider, for example, second harmonic, the limiting case of second harmonic, then you would see that for second harmonic, you would require for phase matching that the refractive index of the second harmonic should be equal to the refractive index of the fundamental, which is, of course, not possible because the refractive index will increase. So in fact, the first experiments on nonlinear optics, they got extremely low efficiencies because they didn't have phase matching. Then people started to realize that they had to play some trick. And the classical trick is using birefringent materials. So what are birefringent materials? Birefringent materials are materials in which the refractive index depends not only on the frequency, but also on the polarization and on the propagation direction. So if you have a birefringent material, in this case, I am simplifying to the case of a uniaxial crystal. It's a particularly simple case, but you can generalize it. But just to understand, this is enough for us. So you have one so-called optical axis, and if you propagate with a wave vector that forms an angle theta with respect to the optical axis, then two orthogonal polarizations, they will see two different refractive indexes, the so-called ordinary refractive index, which is independent of the propagation direction, and the extraordinary index, which depends on the angle theta. And here you can see the example of a so-called negative uniaxial crystal, where this extraordinary index, which depends on theta, is lower than the ordinary index. So you see that according to your angle theta, you will get that the ordinary index is always the same, while the extraordinary index will, you can define it on this so-called index ellipsoid, and it can go from NO to some value. Okay? Now, how does it work? Essentially, the trick is you want to put the highest in frequency wave, the omega 3, you want to polarize it along the direction giving the lower refractive index. And in this way, you can compensate for the increase of refractive index with frequency. So, for example, in this is called type 1 phase matching. So here you put the high frequency omega 3 with the extraordinary index, and then you put the two lower frequencies with the ordinary index. You can also mix things. You can do what is called the type 2 phase matching. In this case, you are putting one of the signal in either with extraordinary index. This is also sometimes possible. Now, of course, it is not always, not necessarily this will work. Not in every crystal, not for every three wavelengths that you want, or frequency you want to phase match, you can satisfy this condition. But luckily enough, for many crystals and for many frequency ranges, you can satisfy this condition, and so you can set delta K to zero. Okay? Now, let me skip maybe. You can do the calculation. Essentially, the point is that you can find a very specific propagation direction along which you will get the phase matching. You will satisfy this condition. And in fact, anybody of you who has anybody worked with nonlinear crystals? You have worked. So what do you need to do if you work with a nonlinear crystal? When you align the crystal, you need to typically tilt. And you will see it's extremely sensitive. So if you are off by a few degrees, you will see non-linearity. If you get the right angle, boom, everything explodes. For example, if you do second harmonic generation, you will see the light green, for example, if you do second harmonic of the infra. So it is really critical to propagate along this angle that guarantees the phase matching. So phase matching is the key to nonlinear optics. If you don't achieve phase matching, the efficiency will drop very quickly. Now, just to mention, another. This is like the traditional way to do phase matching. There is another way of doing phase matching, which involves these special crystals that are called periodically polled crystals. So, how do they work? These crystals, so the nonlinear crystals are typically ferroelectric crystals. So they have ferroelectric domains that have a specific alignment. So there is a procedure, so-called periodic polling, by which you can reverse the alignment of these domains. And in this way, you can introduce a periodic modulation of the sign of this nonlinear coefficient chi2. So you go from plus chi2 to minus chi2, plus chi2, minus chi2. And in this way, you do what is called quasi-phase matching. And now, this is it may seem more complicated. Why should I do it? The reason is that I can use quasi-phase matching in crystals with much higher values of chi2 than those for which I can use traditional birefringence. So it is still worth to go to this very complicated procedure of fabricating such a crystal, because I can exploit a huge nonlinear coefficient. Now, let me skip a few slides because I'm running over time. Let me just now show you a conceptual scheme of an optical parametric amplifier. So you start from a laser source. Typically, it's a laser in the infrared. It can be titanium sapphire or 800 nanometer. Can be an ytterbium laser at 1 micron. Then you generate the pump. Now, the pump, you can generate it either directly or, for example, you can do also nonlinear optics. You can do second harmonic, for example, and go from the red to the blue. You can do third harmonic. So you can change the frequency of your pump with the first nonlinear optical process. Then you have what is called a seed generation. So you need now to generate some photons at the signal frequency. You need to start with something if you want to amplify. And the way to do it is typically the white light continuum. So this is a third order nonlinear process. So if you come to our labs later, you will see it probably. I don't have the time to explain it, but this provides some photons at the signal. Then you can amplify it, and you can have several stages of amplifier. And then, if you want, in the very last stage, you can have what is called the pulse compressor. So you can generate now pulses that contain different colors, and they are not necessarily all coming together. So with compression, you can easily rearrange these colors to be all simultaneously, to get the shortest possible path. So this is a very general scheme, and it can be applied to many different lasers. And just to show you, I'm now considering here several lasers, the most common, like the titanium sapphire, the second harmonic of titanium sapphire, the ytterbium laser at 1 micron, second harmonic and third harmonic of ytterbium. I'm considering this as the pump. And for each pump, I get a certain frequency tunability. And here I am limited to 3 micron, typically because the BBO crystal is not transparent for longer wavelengths. You can get some crystals that go slightly longer. But you can see that basically, with you can really get a huge tunability from, let's say, 400 nanometer to 3 micron. So really, you can continuously tune your output over all these very broad bandwidths. And then that's not the end, because you can even go to higher frequencies or lower frequencies by doing additional second-order processes, like, for example, difference frequency generation. It can get you down to the mid-IR, maybe 3 to 10, 20 micron. Or you can do some frequency, and you can go all the way to the ultraviolet. So you can really cover. You take one laser, and you can generate, you can basically dial in any color you want, and you will generate it through this nonlinear optical process. And this is, of course, very powerful for many applications, especially for the application that I like to do in my lab, which is spectroscopy, because you can really go and look at, excite different systems and look at different processes. Okay, my time is running over. So basically, conclusions, OPAs are based on a second-order nonlinear process, whereby is this famous photon cutter. You annihilate one pump, and you create simultaneously signal and hydra photons in such a way that the signal, the sum of the energies of signal and hydra equals the sum of the energy of the pump. They work very well with femtosecond pulses because they need, it's a nonlinear process, so it needs high peak powers. So once you have high peak powers, you get high efficiencies, and these devices work. And basically, what can they do? You start from a fixed frequency laser, for example, a laser working at 1 micron. You put an OPO or an OPA in front of this laser, and you get tunable pulses. So you can basically almost arbitrarily tune your frequency by using these nonlinear optics. And this is very powerful, very important for a great variety of applications. So to conclude, a few references. There are two review articles. One is quite old now, and one is more recent. This is really, if you really want to learn how these OPAs work and how all the equations and the physics, I would recommend you this tutorial article that we wrote with Christian Manzoni a couple of years ago. And with this, I thank you for your attention.
Yes. I think very clear. So yeah, exactly. I suggest to the student to download the tutorial paper with Christian, because it's really a sort of ABC to just to how to build an OPA and using a laser. Yeah, question.
Okay, thank you, Julie, for this talk. I just wanted to ask. So the generation of the white light.
Yes.
In the system is basically only for convenience, so you have the chance to amplify different colors. But in principle, if you go only in with one color,
well, okay, then you do what is called OPG, or you do what is called optical parametric generation. So you can also essentially, if you go to this configuration, you could avoid completely the seed. So you could just pump, and you would still generate signal and hydra. In this case, you start from vacuum fluctuations. So you start from quantum noise. This is called, sometimes it's called optical parametric generation. Sometimes it's called spontaneous parametric down conversion. So this is, for example, what you do in nonlinear in quantum optics when you want to generate entangled photons. Then you can exploit. But of course, if you start from noise, you will get a very noisy output. So
the seed basically can be only one color. you come and set up with the white light?
Well, if you can make a call, the problem is how do you make, for example, if I start with a laser at 800 nanometer and I want to amplify at 600, how do I make a seed at 600? I can. It's not a trivial problem. Some people have even used a CW laser. In principle, if you get this extremely high gain periodic dipole crystal, you could use even a CW laser to seed an OPA. So you can use, in principle, any, but the most, you can even not put a seed, you're right, but then you will get a very noisy output. You will still get amplification. You will still get amplification from noise, but then you get the fluctuations of order of magnitude. You can saturate it, but I mean, actually, the first OPAs didn't use white light. They used a first stage to generate this spontaneous parametric downconversion, and this was the seed. But this is nowadays nobody uses it. Everybody tries to use a coherent seed. In an OPO, on the other end, then it's like a laser. You start from noise, you don't need a seed. It's just in a laser, you just start from vacuum fluctuations, you amplify one photon, and then you go above threshold.
In the case of the pulsed OPOs?
In the case of the pulsed OPOs. In the CW OPOs, okay, then, yes, but then, yeah, it's CW OPOs, they are also very, yeah, you can do them, they're quite difficult, yes.
I have a question. Because you say OPAs are good for femtosecond, in principle also for attosecond can be?
For attosecond, you need, if you want to have an attosecond pulse, you need to go in the XUV range. Then you need, people have proposed, I mean, you can do this Chi2, you need to do it in a gas, it becomes much more tricky. I mean, yes.
Okay, so if you don't have another question, we can thank again Giulio. So yeah, the people that would like to